apologize, there's a certain quality about this. This is somewhat repetitive, but basically this is a vocabulary lesson and just a little bit of background. I know you're going to be happy you've had this before other things start hitting you, and they're just not going to interpret stuff. A lot of these outside practitioners will just talk to you and be like, what are you doing? And I want you to be ready for that, and you will. This will get you ready. So let's look at the next category here, clindamycin. Clindamycin. The thing you need to know about this is that it is, you mostly have to think about clindamycin as anaerobic coverage. It's got anaerobic coverage, also gram positive for MRSA. It's another one of those drugs like Bactrim. Bactrim and clindamycin are two of the oral agents that you can think about using if you find yourself in a spot where you have to deal with MRSA on an outpatient basis, because clindamycin can be used orally. So its spectrum of activity is gram positives and also anaerobes. Mechanism of action, here it is, clindamycin. It's another one of those drugs that inhibits the ribosomal summute. This is a 50S. They all have to remember it's 50S or 30S. The net effect is the machinery is broken down. There's protein synthesis disruption and all that that implies inside a living organism. Page 19. Adverse effects. Here's what you need to know about clindamycin, because this will happen. It can cause an antibiotic-associated diarrhea that is a result of overgrowth of Clostridium difficile, which is a normal flora in your guts, but not when it overgrows and weeds everything out. Clindamycin kills off enough of the other organisms that it allows Clostridium difficile to overgrow, and it is a diarrhea like you've never seen and like you never want to see. It is so severe, and that Clostridium can so damage a colon, you get a colitis so bad that it may even require a colectomy. So, I mean, it's damaging significant amounts of mucosa into the gut wall. So when people get a Clostridium difficile overgrowth with clindamycin, you have to get rid of it, you have to manage it, you have to pay attention to it. It can be significant. So that you have to remember about clindamycin. If you have a patient on clindamycin, you start seeing the person complain about diarrhea, start thinking, you got to start remembering some stuff. You can't just go along with, well, let me give you some Metamucil, let me give you some whatever. You need to start thinking worst case with that. Okay, another one. Metronidazole. This one's kind of interesting. Okay, metronidazole, also think anaerobes. It's another one that has an anaerobic coverage. And it's anaerobes below the diaphragm, so you're talking about lower intestine, you know, colon area, peritoneum, it's those organisms. And it's also effective for protozoa. You'll see metronidazole, also called flagyl, for a lot of the tropical or weird diseases. It's part of vacation packs when you go to different countries because of the problem with protozoa in water supplies, you know, aren't as clean or as managed that you might get used to in this country. So flagyl is available for IV and PO use. Anaerobic, also protozoal, and it can also deal with Clostridium difficile. So you end up with a clindamycin-induced overgrowth, and you may need to come back with the flagyl-induced solution, you know, to take care of that. What does it do? It inhibits nucleic acid synthesis, resulting in cell death. I'm not caring about how much detail you have here, but actually metronidazole has to get reduced into a metabolite, and the reducing agent is ferredoxin. It gives its electrons over here and it loses them, so ferredoxin becomes oxidized. Those electrons go to metronidazole, it becomes reduced, and then that metabolite is what disrupts DNA synthesis and function. So, if you remember, inhibits nucleic acid synthesis, resulting in cell death. That's all you need to know. We're not worried about it at any level greater than that for you all at this point. It is a drug that does have drug interactions. If you look under the pharmacodynamic pharmacokinetic section, it interacts with warfarin, and it causes an increased INR. It's a problem, but it's not the same level as Bactrim, but still it needs to be managed and attended to. And in specific patients, it might be quite significant. The other thing it does that you have to know about is it can cause a disulfiram-like reaction. Do any of y'all know what disulfiram is? Okay, probably it used to be more commonly known. It is a drug that's used in alcohol detox. It's it's a preventive agent. You have the person take disulfiram, and if they decide they want to drink, they get so sick they won't drink again. I mean, it causes a toxic reaction. I don't know if they're doing disulfiram much anymore for management or not. It's a deterrent, you know, so you take something every day that then you just, if you ever break faith and drink while you're taking disulfiram, you'll be so sick you can't stand yourself. I mean, it's bad sick. But this medicine can cause a disulfiram-like reaction if a person drinks. So if you're giving metronidazole to somebody, they have to know they can't drink alcohol, beer, anything, you know, for a while, you know, while they're using that. The manifestations: flushing, headache, nausea, vomiting, sweating, tachycardia, you think you're going to die. You have to not use alcohol, and then for 2 days afterwards. So it's pretty significant interaction that a person needs to know about. Okay. Moving on. Vancomycin. Look how big that molecule is. It's gigantic. It's a glycopeptide antibiotic. So it's got many sugar units all stuck together with peptides, amino acids. You see those amino acids all strung throughout this chain through here. It's just a gigantic, and these are the sugar, these are the glycol part. Remember those the way glucose molecules fold up, and they will put them in representations like this. It is used in the hospital setting. You will not see it walking around outpatient. It's usually empiric coverage for resistant gram-negative organisms, for example, MRSA. 3 in your list of numbers. It should only be chosen for therapy. No other alternatives are available to reduce the incidence of resistance. So vancomycin is one of the big guns. When you go to vancomycin, you've got problems that otherwise can't be solved with other medications. And then 6, it is bactericidal with a concentration-independent killing effect. Okay. So it's time-dependent, concentration-independent. Spectrum of activities, we already said gram-positive, especially strep, staph, and enterococcus. Don't worry about VRE, but VRE stands for vancomycin-resistant enterococcus. Just for notes. And how does it work? Okay, it does this. It interferes with the peptidoglycan structure, synthesis of a cell wall. Here's that the peptidoglycan structure. You see they have side chains coming off of these peptidoglycan units. And in that side arm, you have D-alanine. And vancomycin binds right there. It binds to the D-alanine, and it prevents cross-linking from happening. And this is part of what creates integrity in that cell wall. When vancomycin sticks here and here and everywhere else, and all these little projections coming off that peptidoglycan structure, you cannot get cross-linkages anymore. And the cell wall eventually gets weak, fragile, it breaks, and that kind of does the killing. So it causes cell wall synthesis disruption. I've already mentioned under pharmacovigilance its concentration independent killing effect. It is a poor oral absorption, stays in the GI tract, but there is an oral formulation used only for Clostridium difficile infections. You don't see it used very often, you see other things. The last thing I'll mention to you, but you can italicize, is therapeutic drug levels. I know that y'all haven't had it very much. I think Dr. Latessi probably talked a little bit about pharmacokinetics and how drugs levels, you know, work in the body. This is one of those drugs that actually has to be monitored by drug levels, where there's a sample of blood drawn. They analyze it for how much vancomycin is in it, and you have to dose it to certain levels. And you'll see here, the dosing is always based on the trough level. What is the lowest point? You give a dose and it goes all the time. And right before you dose again, you draw the blood sample, see where is it here. Then you dose, the level comes up again, and it gradually falls off, and then you draw it at that point. And the trough level has to stay at a certain point. They've got trough levels for certain types of infections, but it does require therapy and drug monitoring for benefit. I'm not asking y'all to know that. I just want you to be aware that it's a drug. You don't just pick a dose and go on. You have to determine an initial dose based on some algorithms and nomograms, but it requires ongoing continual monitoring and dosing adjustment. So it's a fine-tuning type thing. But all I want you to know is that it's monitored for therapeutic. You don't have to remember levels or for what reasons or anything like that. It's not a prescribe it and move on type drug. If you look up page 21, it does have two adverse effects that are very significant. Red band syndrome, ever heard of that? Okay. It happens with infusions of vancomycin. It's called a red band syndrome because that's what the patient turns into. They become red. And obviously that's described in a Caucasian patient with taking and become red, but any patient can have the red band syndrome. It's an infusion-related reaction, and it's significant enough that you actually pre-treat people with antihistamines and other agents to keep that from happening. But it also causes low blood pressure, flushing, and a rash. And it will resolve itself if you slow down the infusion rate. So it's one of those medicines, not only has to be monitored, but how you administer it, what length of time. It requires a lot of fine-tuning to do it well. The other thing it does is nephrotoxicity. You have to always know vancomycin nephrotoxicity, because it's uncommon. But if it happens, it is bad. You can wipe a person's kidneys out, and that would be a malpractice thing as well. Increased incidence with the higher doses, and if the person is also using an aminoglycoside, which we're going to talk about. So vancomycin by itself can cause it rarely, but when it happens, it's major. If you have vancomycin and aminoglycoside together, the incidence is much higher, and you really have to monitor renal function all along. Okay, and then finally, aminoglycosides, here's a couple, gentamicin, tobramycin, we go off the drugs. Aminoglycosides have very good gram-negative activity, especially Pseudomonas, but the side effects are a problem. When you hear aminoglycoside, think gram-negative, think Pseudomonas. It's very often added to drugs to get gram-negative and Pseudomonas, so it's a part of a combo a lot of times. Its dosing is very finicky. I'm not going to ask you to know anything about that, but aminoglycoside drug levels also can be monitored. So dosing, it's not intuitive. It's somewhat of an art, but it is monitored with drug levels also. It's concentration-dependent killing, so you have to get a high enough level often enough, and it's bactericidal. The two agents are gentamicin and tobramycin. There are brand names for those things, but hardly worth remembering because the generic is almost always what's purchased and used. They've been around for 40-plus years at this point, so they're in good shape. Spectrum of activity, as I said, aerobic gram-negatives, that include Pseudomonas and the Enterobacteriaceae. Gram-negatives, synergistic effect of gentamicin only, so you're only going to use it in synergy for gram-positives. Don't worry about the rest of that, those bullets up under there. If you know aerobic gram-negatives that include Pseudomonas and Enterobacteriaceae, and you know gram-positives and synergy, that'll be enough. In synergy with other antibiotics. Mechanism of action, it's one that binds 30S and 50S subunits. So the other ones is either 30S or 50S. This one binds onto both of them and inhibits bacterial protein synthesis. In pharmacodynamics, it has additive nephrotoxic effects with vancomycin, which is important to remember. I'm not worried anything about the dosing on that. On page 22, under adverse effects, there are two that you need to know about. Nephrotoxicity can occur, but it's reversible with aminoglycosides, but you have to monitor it to get the reversal. And the other one that is not reversible is ototoxicity. You can cause a person to lose their hearing. And it is related to the age of a person, but also the dose they get. So hearing loss would be a pretty bad thing for those people. So you do monitor levels, and that has implications for risk for ototoxicity. Okay. Any questions on those? I've really just kind of given a very broad overview, which is what I want you to have for right now. Any questions on that stuff? What you need to know? There's some factoids in here, but they are not going to be as hard to sort out as you might think. Okay. Next, page 22, antimicrobials for complicated gram-positive infections. It's just all in there for interest. Don't worry about it. You may need to look at it later. I'm just going to move right on beyond all that. Through page 24, once you look at page 25, there is a nice table I put together for you that could be helpful in remembering some stuff. I didn't cover everything on here, but I picked out most of the ones that are important for you to know for right now. Does that make sense? What you need to know. All right. Let's see. All right. Here's the last thing I want to talk to you about, and I have debated how much and in what way I want to present this, because it actually is at a place I don't think I need you to be at just yet, but I want to give you a preview. I actually want to come back and talk to y'all about this after you've had some clinical medicine where you have more context, because if I go through this thing right now, it's going to be really what you do and what you're going to do with that. No test off of this, none at all. It's just there for you. You got your objectives, you know what I want you to know. It's very clear, and I went over every single thing I want you to know. If you've heard me and you've listened and you studied your stuff, you're going to get every question right. I'm looking for 100%. But I'm giving you this because you need this, and this is how you actually practice. I just want to orient you to it, but I'm not testing it. I'm just going to give you, point out a few things that are of interest. This is 10 steps to ensure appropriate antimicrobial drug selection. I know the students that are already out on their clinical phase want this stuff, and I was thinking about them when I put it together for them. But I'm just going to walk you through some of it very globally so you can kind of see what the thinking is. And I'm thinking about where to put this back. I think it may need to come back maybe after you've done pulmonology, maybe in cardiology, biology, maybe after that, but maybe at the end of this first semester just to kind of look at it. Because by then you will have had enough. And the anxiety starts to grow. I don't think I can manage antibiotics. I'm not sure. There's so much stuff. How do you know? You get worried. And that's normal. Okay, it's not abnormal to think that way. But I do think coming back and looking at this approach again is fine. And then we need to look at it again probably in the beginning of the fall. And then again in December before we go on rotation. So just to orient you to how people think about this, it's more complex than you think. And as you get more experienced and deeper into practice, a lot of this just happens very rapidly, but this is a break it down into step by step. I do stuff now, and I just almost go right to the end. It's like, well, how'd you get there? Well, my little brain has computerized a lot of this stuff, and you just kind of you get there, but you don't think about all the assumptions you make or the questions you answer. And this is a slow it down method so you understand what questions are to be asked or what you need to think about. To get to the answer. So, look at the 10 questions. I put them all in bold. First question, is an antibiotic necessary? I'm just going to flip through it and come back and highlight some parts. Is an antibiotic necessary? That's all about how do you confirm infection. Y'all haven't been taught how to confirm infection. You know, if they're hot, if they're coughing, stuff, but okay, that's all part of it. But not always. Okay, so first thing is, is an antibiotic necessary? That comes down to diagnosis, what it is, where it is, what else is going on. But that's the first question. Turn over to page 27. The next question is, what type of therapy is indicated for that person? And by type, is it prophylactic therapy, primary or secondary? Is it empiric therapy, or is it definitive targeted specific therapy? We'll come back to this. I just want you to see the questions. But first question, is an antibiotic necessary, yes or no? That's the diagnostic piece. Number two, if one's indicated, then what kind of therapy are we talking about? Are we treating something we know? Are we treating something presumptively? Are we trying to prevent something from happening? Those are important questions. Turn to page 28. Number three, which antibiotic should be selected? Good question. You've just seen all this stuff out there? Half of them say gram-positive and gram-negative. Which ones would you pick? You know, they're all covered. The first time you hear this stuff, it seems like it's all kind of the same, but maybe a little bit different. How do you know? Okay, this gets into how do you begin thinking about it. Turn to the next page. Turn to two pages down, page 30. Once you figure out what agent to think about using, then you have to think about dose and regimen. Is it IV? Is it PO? Is it topical cream? How do you do that? And then how much do you give? How long do you give it? So what, how much, how long, and by what route? You got to think about those things. And it's not just always so obvious. It's not always a capsule or pill makes sense. You need to think about why are you doing this versus the other. Look at number five. That's that which route is best. A lot of implications there. What is the duration? And then is combination therapy indicated? Sometimes you see people on two antibiotics. Your first thought might be, let's just overdo it. No, some infections it's not. I'll give you an example. TB. How many drugs do you usually take to treat TB? It can be three or four, depending on where you're coming from. Okay, what's prophylaxis against TB if you've been exposed but aren't infected? Could be a drug, could be two drugs, depending on where you came from, could be three. You know, so there's factors that get into that. Is combination therapy indicated? If you're in the hospital getting ready to go to ICU with a pneumonia that's multiflora in an immunocompromised person, and you're thinking about using a respirator, death is on the way. And you better have multiple antibiotics with multiple power and with rapid speed and monitoring. Give you a story about infectious disease. I had just finished my graduate program in clinical pharmacy, and I was doing a residency, and I was on an internal medicine team, and we were receiving in the ER. And so the patient comes in, 28-year-old woman. I remember her name. I can't say it for HIPAA reasons, but I never forgot her name. It's one of those people that just really lands on you because it's like, man, stuff can happen to people. She came in the emergency room in the evening. She was a Hispanic lady, and she had two small children and a husband, and she had a boil on her buttock. I mean, it's pretty big, a carbuncle, furuncle, boil, rosin, whatever region of the country you come from. It was big, it was impressive. And she had been trying to pick it. She was trying to pop it. You know how people do. But it was one of those things that was probably, it probably was erythematous at this level, like 5 inches across. It was gigantic, and it was just an infected follicle that had just gotten large. So she started feeling sick that day when she just didn't feel good. And she had this big old thing, and she had a little bit of a fever. So the team worked her up. Okay, we'll put you on something that covers Staph aureus. Back in the day, methicillin resistant didn't exist. I'm serious. This was like 81, 82. Another thing about the stuff, if it's Staph, you just treat your Staph. So put her on some Staph and stuff, and she put her on up in the floor. They were thinking about IV, weren't sure they needed to do that, but they were probably going to do it because she had messed with the sore for so long. She just kept getting sicker and sicker. I mean, like downhill sicker. This was like hour by hour. So I think we received her probably, I don't know, 3 or 4. Nobody's sick ever comes in the morning. I always wait the day. You know, I think it'll tough it out, but I'm getting worse. I probably better go in. So she was on the floor, and then she started getting very sick, and she was having difficulty breathing, okay, getting your x-rays and all this stuff, and her lungs were, so she had a pneumonia, so that she couldn't breathe. I mean, her arterial blood gases were dropping out of sight, so we moved her into the intensive care unit, and I'm here with this intern, this resident. We're all like, what? They're trying to figure out what to do with this person. And we had to put her on a respirator about 12 hours after admission because she was that sick. She had a rapidly progressive pneumonia. So we knew it was some bad bug. Is it Pseudomonas? Is it some kind of Staph that's not responding? What is it? So she got on the ventilator. All just went downhill, had to be on the ventilator. And her husband's out there like, what's wrong with my wife? This is Austin, Texas. What's wrong with my wife? We don't know. She's got children. She needs to come home. She can't come home. You can't even come back in here right now. Everybody was gowned up all the time, gloves everywhere, because she felt like it was something that was really weird. And it was. So it kind of moved ahead a little bit longer. She went downhill. We got gram stains, gram positive coccus. It was a staph, more likely cultured out. It just didn't respond to a lot of antibiotics back in the day. And she just kept staying bad, and her lungs just whited out. For those of you who've been in practice, you know when you take the lung picture, when you've got lots of pus and inflammation, it just looks all white on the fields. Normally, it's just all black. You know, you see a white outline for the lungs, the different lobes, and then you just see black. It's just straight, the shot goes straight through. Well, it doesn't go straight through when it's all filled up. And she just stayed sick, and we could not get the infection under control, could not get it to go, and she eventually died. Like, I don't know, 6 or 7 days after that, she died. They could not get her off. They could not get off the respirator. They couldn't get her healed up. She just went downhill. She died. And her husband didn't know what was going on, why that happened. It just was this big mystery, and nobody else could figure it out. And we called in the infectious disease person, and there they made recommendations. So she died. Well, that shook me up because she is 28-year-old with two people, and I think I was probably 26 at the time. And you just don't think about dying. You don't think dying's going to happen to your age group. I mean, we all know it can happen, but we just don't think it's going to happen. And so what happened is that she actually had staph in that boil, and she had picked the boil, and she had become septic, which means the infections in her bloodstream, it just went everywhere. And then it got into her lungs, highly vascular organ. It has to be. And so she was seeded with staph, or it's probably methicillin resistant, probably penicillinase producing. And no antibiotic would really touch her, and she just died. She just suffocated. I mean, she filled up, and when your lungs are filled up with pus, and the oxygen exchange ability, all the alveoli are eaten up. I mean, there's just no interface for air and bloodstream. It's just gone. There's nothing you can do. I mean, there's just nothing you can do at all. They did an autopsy on her, and we took her lungs out. They brought them back to a morning report, where we always would bring the PATH stuff in. If you have an impressive heart attack, a stroke or something like that, you bring the brain or the heart or whatever. And we brought her lungs in, and they weighed probably 4 to 5 times. Their lungs are not very heavy. I mean, they're not. And these are just like heavy. The pan was just so heavy because they were filled up. So she got seeded with a staph aureus that was probably just kind of ordinary, got an infection, picked it, got in her bloodstream, it got into her lungs, it rapidly advanced, no antibiotic would take care of her, and she died. And then they brought her lungs in so we could kind of see what happened to her. So the one take-home message, the team was all upset because it was like, what did we do wrong? Well, probably nothing. I don't know that anybody would have done anything differently. I remember we were running all kinds of serum cidal levels. You can get blood levels, bactericidal levels of antibiotics. You do all kinds of tests. There was all kinds of stuff going on, and you just couldn't treat her. It wasn't to be treated. So it impressed me that things that don't look like they're a big deal could be a big deal. Maybe, you know, 19 times out of 20 or 99 times out of 100, nothing's going to happen, but sometimes it can. So you have to always be operating like it's that percent and thinking through stuff very carefully so that you don't get a bad outcome, and even then you're still get a bad outcome. You know, every once in a while stuff will happen. But that was impressive. We had combo therapy going, we had everything, and it just wasn't to be. But isn't that surprising? And I've seen it before. I had another patient, like another infection problem. Had a diabetic man I'd been seeing for a long time. And he was so high risk for everything. And you're always worried about infections in a diabetic because their immune system is suppressed. It just doesn't work as well. And you're worried about their feet, circulation, nerves are impaired. They don't feel things. And this man had stepped on a straight pin in the end, we figured this out, and didn't feel it because he was going barefoot in the house. You don't go barefoot in the house when you have diabetes and can't feel the floor. All kinds of things can get in your feet. You'd be surprised. I've seen nails, pins, and don't even know it's there. Just step on it, go on. It just goes in there and lodges with all the bacteria that are sitting on top of it. And he came in to see me, and he had this foot infection going on for about 3 weeks. And what I, every time I tell them, I say, if you ever get a sore on your foot, you have to call us that day. Don't wait. Come down here. This man lived 3 hours away. I was at the VA, and he was in my clinic in the VA. And I said, you have to come back. I know it's bad, but it'll be bad if you don't come. Well, when he sat there, this man was like 37 years old. And he said, well, it was just a long way. I thought it would be okay if I could just tell him that got back in here. So he had 3 weeks of this foot thing going. Well, here's the he came in, looked kind of sick. His ulcer was awful. It's like, how more? If I saw that, I'd be freaking out. Deep thing, just kind of deep down. I looked in, you know, and it's like, I thought I could see the bone, but I wasn't going to poke down there and just shit. It's like it was a mess. Took him over to the ER to get him admitted. He got admitted. He got sick. He got septic. He went to the ICU. He got on the respirator. He died in 12 hours. I saw him at like 9 a.m. He was dead by midnight. And I remember they called back, and I was telling him everything. And I said, well, didn't this man know to do that? And I said, absolutely knew what to do. It's all been documented for forever. He was just kind of stubborn about stuff. And he came in, and it was too late. And it can be too late sometimes. So I'm always telling folks, listen, don't mess around with stuff when you have risk factors for a bad outcome. They never think it's them. You won't think it's you. It can be you. It can be somebody. So he died. That's two of them. And I thought, okay, I'm on top of it. I'll pay attention to it. But let me move on from page 30. Combo therapies and indicator. Then number 8, how does antimicrobial resistance factor into the equation? Is the presumptive organism and site and host factor suggestive of a bad outcome, or are they not? Because you have to treat presumptively until you can know for a fact what things are. So with antibiotic therapy, a lot of times you come out with a big spectrum to cover all that could really hurt that person until you know what it is, at which point you can wean it down. But you can't use one and miss when you need to be broad to gather until you can be sure what the organisms are. And then 9, how do I monitor the patient's response to therapy? And then number 10 on page 32, should the antibiotic regimen be changed based on the patient's response, either a different organ, either a different antibiotic, or less as time goes by? So those are the questions that you have to look at that are important for decision making. And I would suggest you just probably read through it just to see some of the things I've talked about will begin to show up in there. But if I could do anything for you, just read it without worrying about knowing everything. Begin to take in what are the factoids that are part of decision making and just immerse yourself in it. Don't study it, just read it, and then listen as people talk, and then we need to come back and revisit it again when you have more context. Okay. Otherwise, it's going to be an activity of obsessive detail, and you won't know what it's applying to or how you should think about it. Okay. But I want you to have it. So we're not done. I'll come back. But for right now, this is a good entry point. So questions about anything related to this class, this topic, or anything beyond up to this point? Anything? Y'all quiet. Do you know what you need to know? Are y'all tired? Mm-hmm. See, it's, you came in at 9, pretty good. 10, pretty good. 11, 25 till 12. Y'all are gone again. So sorry. Okay. Well, this will give y'all a chance to kind of get out and get something to eat if you want to come back.